It's a privilege to be here. It's also a privilege to be editor of JAM. It's an enormous honor. I described the process of, they started with 200 people, then 50 people. Then in America, we have something in basketball called March Madness when they go 64-32. I was the last person standing at the end of all those interviews, so I think that's how I got the job. I'm going to talk a bit about JAMA. I thought it'd be helpful to just highlight some of my experience and changes and then future publications. So I would say start with the recognition that in general journals have not been innovative. They've been slow adopters, and they continue to believe they can dictate to the people who use their journals and their internet sites. So I think the dynamic between people who come to our website or come to our journal needs to change. I never thought that smartphones would be a disruptive technology. I believe tablets are a disruptive technology. So I could never read much on a smartphone, but I went to a meeting of the Archives of Psychiatry, and it's a very senior editorial board. And one of the senior editors who used to travel with lots of journals just brought her tablet. And I knew the world had fundamentally changed. So my wife is allergic to technology. And so when I moved to Chicago, I got her a tablet. And when she visits me, she brings only her tablet and her purse. She does have clothes in Chicago. And she gets 10 magazines on her tablet. She's done away with every subscription, okay? So I really recognize that the world in 10 years, because of the tablet, is very different than what the world looks like now. I really do want to acknowledge the people at BMJ. That's where I grew up as a journal editor. I was enormously fortunate. So Richard Smith, Fee Godley, Tony Delamont, Jane Smith, and then Peter and Janet O'Flaherty have been wonderful mentors for me. And now at JAMA, I walk hand in hand with our publisher, Betsy Jones, who's been a wonderful partner. And then the senior staff there have been fantastic. It's a little more than 100 years old, which in England I know means it's a youngster. It's a general medical journal. I don't think I need to tell anyone in this room that it would be considered one of the 6 or 7 or 8 most elite journals in the world by virtually any measure, of which the most prominent measure is the impact factor. I'm one of the few editors who believes that the impact factor is enormously valuable. I think if and when it's measured accurately and fairly, it is actually a very good measure. I think the issues that I have with ISI is that article types in one journal may be counted in the denominator, but not in another journal. And I think they need to be more transparent about how they count. It's published 48 times a year. We have theme issues, which is a little different than the other journals. And so these are the covers of 2 theme issues. I will return to the covers, which have been an institution at JAMA for 20 years. But actually, we didn't always have fine art on the cover. There was a time before we had fine art. And believe it or not, in the interview process, I was asked more questions about the cover of JAMA than any other single question I received. I have to say, and it's not to embarrass anyone, my son, when the archives began to arrive at our door every week, he asked me if the person who was choosing the artwork was alive or dead. Okay, and I really listen when someone who's 20 years old tells me something about my journal. The reason? That 20-year-old is my future. Okay, so when a 20-year-old or a 25-year-old or a 30-year-old says something, so when people came to our house and they would see all of the other journals in the stable, the archives journals, they wanted to know, is this preserved material or is this new material? They're very anxious about what the word archives means. And it's the flagship publication of the AMA. The covers through the years, very traditional. I think one of the issues that's very distinguishing, NEJM, clearly has its table of contents. Lancet has its quote. BMJ has a medical illustration. And really, these have been our covers for the last 20 plus years. These are the covers currently. You'll see some changes that I've instituted since since July. And I think the first question is this welcoming? If you were passing this around in a table, does this make you come into the journal? Does it say to you, come and see what's inside? Okay? I've always said a journal that rests in a corner collecting dust isn't a very good journal. And so one of the first questions I've had to ask is whether or not this is really helpful. I'm a pediatrician. My training is in epidemiology and biostatistics. I first began in medical publishing in 2000. I became editor-in-chief of Archives of Disease and Childhood in 2003. I was enormously fortunate at BMJ Publishing to be involved in much more than just the print and web delivery of Archives of Disease and Childhood. So BMJ Learning, other centers that are at BMJ, was something that I was involved in over the 8 or 10 year period. And I think one of the things that I was really interested in doing while I was at ADC was to try to continually innovate. And Richard Smith, just before he left, reminded me, if I only have successes, I've actually failed. Okay. Now, one of the differences is you could fail at ADC and not many people would notice. A failure at JAMA has much more substantial implications. We publish on Tuesday. Every Wednesday I get emails from bloggers about something that's wrong in the journal. Okay? So I think for the weeklies, they're under a microscope in a way that monthlies may not be. And so that does create, I think, for the editors, greater hesitancy about some of the things that they may try. One of the things that people ask me about, so JAMA is particularly famous for its humanities section. So the cover, it has something called A Piece of My Mind. It has poetry. We have JAMA 100 years ago. And on the other hand, JAMA and the BMJ have been leaders in the evidence-based medicine movement. So how do you hold evidence versus the power of narrative? How do you balance those two? And I think probably in response to the EBM movement over the last 20 years, it started in the 1990s, both in England and Canada. I would say the US was somewhat late entering the evidence-based medicine movement, because for people from the US, they know that we have an unlimited healthcare bill. We will spend any amount of money on healthcare. And I come from Massachusetts, which is the single most expensive place in the world to get healthcare. Okay? We had no limit when it would come to spending dollars. So the reason the EBM movement starts in Canada and the UK is you start with a box around what you'll spend on healthcare. So you have much more difficult decisions to make. But I continue to believe that the best of medicine is a combination of evidence and narrative. So I have reassured the current staff that the power of the humanities section will not leave JAMA. In fact, we've tried to enhance it in very specific ways. This represents for me a very different conceptual view of what journals are. And editors really need to try to grapple with this and make decisions about how they see a journal and or its accompanying website. We have readers, we have listeners, we have viewers, we have learners, and we have networkers. This is a very different conceptual model than, say, we have the print and we have the web. It is who uses our journals. And I think journals need to fill in these boxes and understand what they want to emphasize. Who do they want to appeal to? Can they create content for all five of these groups? And editors and publishers must really try to understand how they want to grapple with this dynamic. 300,000 subscribers, 75,000 eTalk users, 32 million page views. It's very high, not as high as other journals, but good. 50,000 mobile device contacts per month, and we don't have an app, okay? God knows what that number will be when we actually have a working app, which will debut in the next month or two. 25,000 people listen to the editor's podcast each week. 15,000 here are other author podcasts. Under viewers, last year 1 billion people saw our author videos. 1 billion people.
We average 20 million viewers of our author videos a week. The number is staggering. How do we get to that number? We have an original article each week. We create an accompanying author video. That video is produced for public consumption and is given free to the media outlets, 5,000 media outlets. For an example, about 2 months ago, we had a paper about how women present with myocardial infarction versus men. It played on ABC, NBC, CBS, Fox, PBS, and CNN. 80 million people saw it the day after it debuted, because we know how many people are seeing those channels. And so about 20 million people a week see our author videos. What we began doing in August was to take that same video, instead of producing it for the public, to produce it for healthcare professionals. The viewership on that's been about 10,000 people per week. So what we've tried to do is to take content, manipulate that content to broaden the audience. In addition, the author video that's produced for physicians is now available as audio only. So in some regards, it's a twofer. You create the video, but then you have an audio to go with it. And it's very conceivable to me that in the coming years, we will be able to take that audio and splice it in to an audio of the article in a way that would create an automatic dialogue between someone coming to our website and that article. Learners, 3,000 people participate in our weekly CME quizzes. Around the world, everyone recognizes that physicians, other health professionals need to keep up. Going to meetings is becoming a little more difficult, far more expensive. If you read what John Ioannidis wrote in JAMA last week, he's concerned that creating these kind of small cities around the country, around the world, may not be the most effective way to teach people. And he thinks there's other ways to do CME. We have 2,600 readers' responses to our clinical challengers, a clinical challenge I'll show you in a bit. And then we're just beginning to understand bloggers, tweeters, and Facebook. Some journals have been very active in that environment. I think journal editors are probably divided about it for a host of different reasons. We have very stringent criteria around embargoes on our articles. Our social networkers would like me to blog. I've resisted blogging. I think around networkers, it's still uncertain what role it truly plays, other than kind of communicative. I think we don't quite yet know, but I would say most journals are interested in it. Solicit the best content, create new content, present that content creatively, use innovation wisely, and engage our audience. So I do just want to say, I will have made only 3 trips this year unrelated to author outreach. And Peter's a friend, and so I was very pleased to accept the invitation. But the soul of at least our journal and many journals is its original research content. And we all have a great deal of value-added material. Now, it's striking to me that BMJ has minimized its original research content. I would say Fee has approached medical journalism somewhat differently. So they have the PICOs that take up 4 or 5 pages, and then they have 30 pages of other material. So it's kind of striking the approach that Fee has taken. Now, what's interesting, if you look at JAMA, New England Journal, or Lancet, 2/3 of our material is not original research, okay? We publish 12 to 14 pieces each week. 4 to 5 are original research. So even when people say, well, JAMA is an original research journal, it is true. But the majority of material of what we publish, print, and put on the web is not original research. But everything else we do is driven by the quality of our original research, and we're well aware of that. The impact factor for the leading journals is comprised of 70% of original research. So letters, editorials, viewpoints, commentaries, perspectives make up the other 25 to 30%. But 70% of the impact factor for the leading journals is driven by its original research content. hence the need to solicit the best content. We need to create new article types, and so we've created two. We have five more on the drawing board. It takes us a year to develop a new article type. And when I said that to people, they thought I was daydreaming. Well, after we've done one, now they know I'm not daydreaming. Okay. Why does it take so long? We have an idea. We create that idea. So we're deriving that new article type. But then we need to go validate that article type. I have no misconceptions that we know what we're doing. So you then take that article type and then send it to your myriad readers and see if they like it. So I know I think we like it, but the question is, do our readers like it? So we derive it and then we validate it. And then after you're done validating it, you can't debut it until you have a number of them ready to go. So it will take us 6 to 9 months to fully develop and get ready to launch a new article type. And I would say by the end of 2013 or 2014, we'll have developed 5 new article types. We're working very hard on presenting our content creatively. I'll show you some elements of it. I would only say structured abstracts were introduced 31 years ago. They're unchanged in 31 years. That should give us pause, okay? That structured abstracts are unchanged in 31 years. We have begun to create different types of abstracts. And I don't know if people remember the Minority Report by Tom Cruise and he's sitting at a computer moving data around. That's believable to me, that in 3 years, that you would come to an abstract in one of our journals and you could take it apart. You could put it wherever you'd like. I said to the head of our graphics department, who's wonderful, Ronna Henry, that I'd like her to go to 3D meetings this year. She said, why? I said, well, why do you have any notion that we won't go 3D in a year or 2 years? She said it won't happen. She could be right, but I could be right. But again, it would be an example of journals being a very slow adopter. So I think we need to recognize that 3D may become ubiquitous in 5 years. So how will journals respond to a world in which 3D is now readily available? I do like innovation. I don't quite understand all of it, so we continue to struggle about how to use it wisely. And then for me, the key is to engage our audience. Visually, through hearing, through sight, how can we do a better job? As someone said, our goal is to be an agnostic communicator. I have no idea how people want material, but I know this table may be different from this table, and that may be different from that table. My job as a journal editor is to allow people to come to our website or our print and get it in any way that they would like, that I don't predefine how they want information. And so I think it's critical for journals to be agnostic communicators. So how do you make a great journal better? I mean, I'm so enormously blessed. I mean, I'll point out ways in which JAMA can be better, but Kathy did a fabulous job. Before Kathy, George Lundberg did a fabulous job. So people have asked me what it's like, and my first car I got when I was a junior in college in 1973, and it was a Fiat Sport Coupe. And it worked really well for about 3 years, and it would only start every other day. But I loved it for those 3 years. It was pale blue, and I really, coming to JAMA is like rediscovering that car in a barn. It's kind of dusty, and it needs to be shined up, and the leather needs to be improved. So JAMA has always been a wonderful journal, but I think it's gotten a little staid. And so the question is, how do you enliven it? How do you make it more attractive to people? So the way I've approached the year is to understand its content. Do we have an organizational structure at JAMA that will support the vision? What is our technological resources, and then what are our overall resources? So every section, I reviewed every single section. News and media, humanities, poetry, the covers. And I graded it out.
every single section. So our news and media section, which is excellent, when I started, if you looked at the front of the journal, could have 5 pages of street text. I said that needed to end. There's no way you can read 900 words on a page, 5 pages in a row, and have it be attractive for people. So it's now filled with graphics. I went to the Centers for Disease Control and said, can you produce more creative material for us if you want us to use it? They said, no problem. So now they have CDC shorts that are much more visually appealing. We're negotiating with a very famous foundation in the US to create visual depictions of health policy in the United States. I just saw the first example of it. It's outstanding. So again, trying to vary the type of content. Our original research is outstanding. It's amongst the best in the world. We can do better. We can go and solicit better content. And so an enormous amount of effort has gone into author outreach. Our clinical material is good. It can be much better. And so I love the seminar series in Lancet, but does anyone read 15 pages? Okay. I would love to know the readership surveys on those seminars. They're well cited. I wouldn't discontinue them, but is there a way of creating a seminar series where you have a long and a short? So that you take that long seminar series, but then create a shorter version of it, or an audio version of it, or a visual version of it, so that it's far more appealing. And so we've been working in the clinical content area to create longs and shorts. And then our value-added material, so the media section. We've worked hard to understand who our audience is, and it's the fine art of balance between the original content and the value-added material. Organizationally, I have a dual reporting structure. I report to Betsy Jones for business, and then I report to the Journal Oversight Committee for editorial independence. Peter and I were chatting. Thanks to my predecessor, Kathy DeAngelis, who worked very hard to preserve editorial independence at the AMA. I have to say it has simply not been an issue on any single day since I arrived. Not a single person at the AMA has commented on what we published or has suggested what we published. And so I feel very comfortable saying that since my arrival, I've felt as though there's been no threat to editorial independence. I would say there is one very, very different aspect of being at JAMA and the AMA versus being at the BMJ and the BMA. In the UK, about 60 or 70% of physicians are members of the BMA. The BMA is a trade union. It negotiates on behalf of many physicians in this country. That is not true for the AMA. So I would say in the pages of BMJ, many more questions are raised about the BMA than in JAMA. In the United States, about 20 or 25% of physicians are members of the AMA, but the AMA does not negotiate contracts on behalf of physicians. So the relationship of JAMA to the AMA is very different than the relationship of the BMJ to the BMA in terms of critiquing what the parent organization may be doing. Having an organizational structure that supports the vision, we've just hired someone whose only job is to improve clinical content. So we are a little under-resourced. We have many different people working on our clinical content. But when I would ask them, what's the plan for the next 6 months, the next year, or next 18 months, no one could give you a structure of what that section should look like. So we've just hired someone whose full-time job will be to work on the clinical content. I don't think print to publishing to web is any longer a viable option. Material has to come in and quickly be ready to go to print and web simultaneously, and ultimately to audio and visual. And so we were trapped in producing something for print, then trying to understand how it would work on the web. And I think many of you are probably far more advanced than we are. So we're trying to recreate our organizational structure so that once something is accepted, it becomes immediately available for many, many different platforms. And then print-centric to web-centric I'm worried that we are trapped. Many journals are trapped into now believing the web is the future. I'm not certain it is. I think people really need to understand what the viability is of tablets. And I know tablets are derived from the web. The way you may produce material, how you produce material may be very different for a tablet than simply for a website. Technology used to communicate content. I've mentioned intelligent innovation and agnostic communicator. Audio, video, web, multimedia. We've added QR codes that are clearly increasingly important for our readers and users. I do want to begin to experiment with 3D. And we're just beginning to understand what journals should do around holding data and allowing our users to manipulate that data. Now, journals have not wanted to be a data repository for a host of different reasons. As many of you know, particularly in the United States, there's both political and legal pressure to make data much more widely available. The NLN has resisted holding data. Okay, it is very, very complicated to hold data and make it usable for people who come to the website. Journals certainly don't want to be the repository for data. We don't have that capacity. But there are areas in which we believe we can do a better job allowing our users to manipulate data in a way that would benefit them. And so we're just beginning to think about data optimization for 2013 or 2014. And then I've already mentioned that I think tablets really do represent a disruptive technology. We have a single journal. For the first time, internet advertising has passed print advertising in terms of revenue. So what does that mean to the future of the journal? Well, I've argued that in 3 years it's very unclear if we'll ever print that journal again. So for journals that are not associated with societies, don't have the protection of a society, and their print runs are 3,000, 5,000, 7,000, 10,000, and they're kind of independent journals, I think people really need to model having no print. Okay? People have said, will it impact on the notoriety of the journal somehow? Like if the journal isn't around, will it be meaningful? Well, the good news is that young investigators don't care about that anymore. So younger investigators are catching up with us. So would have I said that 20 years ago or 10 years ago? Perhaps not. But I think my younger cohort of investigators who I worked with at BU, they cared less that they saw their name in print. They wanted to see their name in lights, okay, but not in print. And so I think as younger investigators become mid-career, they'll be very, very comfortable without seeing print. And so I think that will help us to move away from print, particularly for journals that have very small runs and don't have the protection of a professional society. This is just a handful of the changes. Illustrated covers, News at JAMA, which is available every day at 2 o'clock. I am so proud of the JAMA Forum, and I'll show you what we've done with it. Weekly videos, use of QR codes, we've doubled podcasts. We made a simple change. We took one of the best parts of our journal was commentaries, and we managed to put it in the back of the journal, and you couldn't find it. So in January, we moved commentaries to the front of the journal, renamed them Viewpoints, and signed up 20 of the best writers in America to write for. John Ives, Abraham Verghese, Victor Fuchs. Our readers love it, and the writers love being in the front of the journal. And then just last week, we introduced something called Dueling Viewpoints. I'll show you some examples of this. I have insisted that we have a single table of contents. One of the things that I love about Lancet or NEJM is you can just see everything that's in the journal on one page. It's wonderful. I should have the incredible talents of the editors of Nature, Cell, and Science, but I struggle that I have to go through 4 or 5 pages and often lots of ads to find all the content. We've developed and introduced Clinical Challenge with some other new article types to follow. I'm enormously pleased that our new website will launch in May or June of this year. with an app to follow, and the journals are being entirely redesigned, and the launch of the new journals will be January 1, 2013. So this debuted in January when we debuted Viewpoints, and this is not an era. If you look very closely, we printed 150,000 of the copies on the left and 150,000 copies on the right. And it was very easy to do, and there are different viewpoints of the buildings in Chicago. And what we've begun to do is we have 5 or 6 theme issues a year, and now we produce illustrated covers for each theme issue. And at least the feedback I get, and you know, I probably just don't read those emails that don't give me positive feedback, or I forget them, is that people have really enjoyed the illustrated covers with the theme issue. It's very galvanizing for our readers to see a theme issue and then this illustrated cover. And I think people have really liked them. And then we have a story about what it was. And I think for our medical illustrators, Cassio and Allison, they've really liked it. But it was fascinating. I was telling Peter, every journal has its traditions. I call them the Ten Commandments of that journal. So I somehow think Moses came down and left the Ten Commandments in my office. I haven't found the tablets, but I've been told that they're there somewhere. And so when we developed the cover, people told me we never allow the artist to have their name on the cover. And I said, why not? And they said, well, we just never do. And I said, well, that doesn't seem very fair. Allison and Cassio created these covers. They spend hours and hours doing it. So I think one of the things that's been rewarding for them, somewhere on these covers is buried their signature. And I think they deserve the credit for it. You should. The one from Tuesday is particularly outstanding. It was on comparative effectiveness research. But I think, you know, this signal to people that we're going to try to experiment, we're going to try to invite people into our journal rather than being static. This is the cover from the 16th. It's on comparative effectiveness research. This is actually an illustration. It's an apples-to-apples comparison. And there was a big press conference on Tuesday. And again, I think it's an example of inviting people into the journal. This is News at JAMA. It's produced by our news media section. It's a short blurb, about 1,000 words, that goes to all of our eTalk subscribers every afternoon at 2 o'clock. Again, trying to invite people into our website, create traffic and noise and different forms of measure. And then for me, someone said, well, how are you going to cover the Supreme Court hearing about healthcare reform in the United States? You know, how quickly could you get an article up? I go, get an article up? It's a news story. Why would you want to get an article up 3 weeks later? That doesn't make a lot of sense to me. So I was very blessed to receive resources from the AMA, and we put together 9 leading health policy experts in the United States to cover health reform and the presidential campaign over the next year. And I really have been very careful about trying to ensure that there's people that represent the broad political spectrum in the United States. So there's David Cutler, a liberal health economist at Harvard, and he's balanced by Stuart Butler and Gail Walensky, who are much more conservative. During the week of the Supreme Court hearings, we put up 2 or 3 blogs a day from these people. Now they blog every Friday, and then they blog intermittently when there's other news. And so it's been trying, it's using a well-established technology to comment on events, but not in a static fashion of print, but in a much more a dynamic fashion. And obviously, David Cutler put up his comment. Gail Walensky didn't agree with it, so she blogged within an hour, and it was not the same as what David had said. And so again, it's this notion of trying to create dialogue. Although it's static dialogue, The future is interactive dialogue with our readers. But that's evolving, and we're probably going to launch something that's more dynamic in the coming months. This was by Larry Gostin, who's our lawyer expert, and he blogged virtually daily about the Supreme Court. You know, that fight over broccoli, can you force people to eat broccoli? Had a number of very funny comments. And people said, well, you know, are you going to really police what they say? And Not really. The blogs would come in, they were 900 or 1,000 words. Either I or Phil Fontanarosa, the other executive editor and the head of news media, we read them. And we said yes or no. We would have a few comments, but they went up within an hour of being received. Okay, these were not editorially reviewed. This was a first for JAMA. I mean, we usually review every paper 10 times to make it perfect. And people said, are you really comfortable doing this? And I said, yes, we need to change. You know, you can't review blogs five times, and you don't want to remove the voice of the writer in the blog. If you do that, you're really not accomplishing very much. So some of these stories are really, they start with kind of amusing observations, which is very, very different than what you would have normally seen in JAMA. And I think for the people who've given us feedback about it, they've really liked it. And one of the people who do it, Aaron Carroll, he's a master at retweeting and putting linking people back to our social media websites. So he's much younger than I am, but he knows exactly how to do it. So the JAMA Forum ended up being picked up by 100 other bloggers over the course of the week, which if you're trying to create traffic and noise, is something that you really would like to accomplish. This is the JAMA report video, and as you can see, we try to designate that an article is accompanied by a JAMA report video. Then we added QR codes in August. This came out of a wonderful discussion with Matt Keenan, who works in publishing, and Maggie Winker, who's our digital editor. I was in the hallway with them, and I said, I was walking around, I saw all these QR codes. I actually figured out how to work it on my smartphone. I kind of liked it. I said, could we do QR codes? This was late July. And it was a hallway conversation. And they said, oh yeah, we think we could do QR codes. I said, how long? I thought they were going to tell me 6 months. They said, it's 2 weeks, okay. I was stunned. So we went from having no QR codes to filling our pages with QR codes. They're being downloaded at a rate of 1,000 per week, okay? And eventually QR codes are going to be able to be downloaded from your computer. So you can scan the QR code on your computer and just walk away with whatever information you'd like. So there are ways of using new technologies that bring in a segment of your audience that otherwise wouldn't be very happy with the way you're displaying information. And it was very funny. Matt said, well, can we do a dry run where we have a QR code, but it doesn't link to anything? And Maggie said, well, we're not very happy with dead-end QR codes. It was just very funny. He didn't realize when you publish weekly, it has to go somewhere. It was a kind of very funny discussion. And what's really interesting is the G8 meeting is in the United States. It was supposed to be in Chicago. We couldn't figure out where the protesters should be, so they solved it by moving the G8 to Camp David, where there'll be no protesters. Anyway, the AMA took out this huge ad that's being given to the 15,000 people who support the G8, and then the NATO meeting is in Chicago. And there's this beautiful ad. It's a view of the world, and we have a global health economics issue timed with the G8 meeting. Okay, that will come out May 16th. And you begin to see what happens when you socialize people. So in the ad, there's a QR code that's going to take people right to our table of contents, and then we're going to open up half the table of contents free. So it's a way, again, of inviting in a segment of the world that's never visited JAMA before. And that's all because the QR codes work so well for us.
This is Eric Topol, and this is, I won't play the whole thing, but this is actually an example of the video that is produced for physicians. And they're Beth?
Dr. Eric Topol, I'm the Chief Academic Officer at Scripps Health in La Jolla, California. The main objective of our trial, known as Bridge, just published in JAMA, was to find a strategy that would help patients who have to be on dual antiplatelet.
Now, it's about 3 minutes in a place for professionals in healthcare. Now, what was interesting is we always worry a little bit about our authors going over the deep side about what their article means, okay? And for people who published or edited, no, authors can do that, okay? So I have to view every one of these before they go live. And we've done one a week since August. And on two occasions, we had to reshoot
the video, because what the author said and what was in their paper were two different things. So I would say authors do on occasion embellish their results, and we do worry about that a bit, because you know, this comes out kind of with the stamp of good housekeeping at JAMA, and so we are conscious of it. So it is interesting, every time you create new content, you have to figure out a way to edit that content in a reasonable way. Now I would say, we do tell the authors that there's not a script, but we'd like them to be careful about not overstating their results. But on two occasions they did, and what was really reassuring for us is when we pointed it out to the authors, they agreed, they recognized that they had overstated their results. But last week, or 2 weeks ago, Don Berwick had his first post-CMS paper. Now, Don was head of Medicaid and Medicare, was considered probably one of the major architects of what was potentially healthcare reform before he left Medicaid and Medicare. The reason reforming Medicare and Medicare in the U.S. is so critical, it consumes about 30-35% of the healthcare dollar bill. Don's first post-CMS piece was in JAMA, but then we had him do the author video. It's an extraordinary 9-minute video. You know, and it's interesting, the news media didn't pick up that video as much as they pick up videos of original research, but we felt like he was such a powerful voice in American medicine that it was worth committing that weekly video to Don. The outreach of your journal was readily apparent to me when a colleague of mine at Watson Clinic, who talked to her mother monthly from a remote village in India, and her mother asked her if she knew anything about a paper by Dr. John Canto in JAMA, which you recently read about. This is enormously gratifying to us. This paper was about how women present with heart attacks differently than men. It was seen by about 60 or 80 million Americans, but we have no idea how many people it was seen by around the world. So trying to get material out to non-physicians, non-healthcare providers is really part of our mission. Presence of QR codes on the pages, so both in the table of contents as well as on the pages. This is a new article type. Other journals have done it, but we've tried to do it a little differently. So we don't ask the reader or the viewer what the answer to the question is. I always really dislike that. That's not how I think. It's not what the answer is. It's what do I do next to find out the answer. To me, we've tried to develop article types that are consistent with diagnostic reasoning, with the diagnostic process. So what we do is you can vote, like many of the journals have polls, but it's what would you do next, and then you click, you find out what the right answer is or what the wrong answer is, and then it gives you information. But we've been very careful in our new article types to field test them with our readers or our users to understand what is it that they think works about it and doesn't work about it. And they said to us, we don't just want the answer to the question, we want to know what we would do next in terms of diagnostic reasoning. And then this was a major change in January. We retired commentaries, renamed them viewpoints, moved them from the back of the journal and the bottom of the table of contents to the top of the masthead, front of the journal, top of the table of contents. But what we also did was take A Piece of My Mind, which is this very, very powerful narrative, and we now include it in the viewpoint section. And that's the balance between evidence and narrative that I've talked about. And one of the consequences of this, last year we had 600 or 700 viewpoints submitted. This year it looks like we'll have well over 1,000. So when you tell the smartest people in medicine, we want to give you a platform, they're interested in participating. And these are 1,200 to 1,500 words. And some of them are really outstanding. Some I'm a little more bored with. We turn them around in 2 or 3 days. Phil and I read virtually every one of them. But they're exciting. And about 2/3 are written by our 20 viewpoint writers. And then about 1/3 are from people who are unassociated with the journal. And I think it's really been a nice addition to the journal. And then this past week, we introduced something called dueling viewpoints for the first time, where we pose a single question, two people write on that question, and then we post a poll. This first question was whether or not a 55-year-old white male with no risk factors should be given a statin. And so far, I looked this morning, about 400 or 500 people have responded. You know, BMJ has something like this. These are written by leading health professionals. But I've been all week getting other questions for Doolin Viewpoint. So a colleague of mine at BU wanted to do this question, whether or not it's really bad if industry buys pizza for medical students. Now, I don't think we're going to do that question, but it was very interesting. But I've gotten a bunch of other questions that people would like to see debated in the pages. Okay, and I can envision a time where there's an additional dialogue around this debate, that you have orchestrated dialogue around different issues in journals. It's not what journals have done, but it's easy for me to imagine. If you look at the pages of The Economist and the website of The Economist, they do orchestrated intellectual debate and discussion, and it's enormously, enormously well done.
And then they vote, and there's a poll, and I think that's a participatory nature that, that journals are trying to engage in. April 1, we announced the creation of the JAMA Network. So JAMA and the Archives Journal has been retired. This is going to become the fabric of our publishing group going forward. It encompasses the 9 archives journals and JAMA. I would say we are certainly thinking about and considering launching other journals. It's been fascinating to watch Lancet. I call them the baby Lancets, but neurology, infectious disease are really outstanding. Neurology's debut impact factor after 2 years was extraordinary. It was 21. The baby Natures, the baby Circulations. You know, BMJ has their own, they have BMJ Plus, BMJ Palliative Care. So I think the journals are trying to understand what their future is. And I think that's probably incumbent on any good editorial leader, editor-in-chief, to think about that. And I think there's going to be a number of other things that we do with the 9 archives journals to create even a stronger feel of something that relates, where the journals relate to one another and relate to something called the JAMA Network. Interestingly enough, New England Journal of Medicine created an NEJM group last week. So if you go to their website, their print, or Journal Watch, they now have NEJM group. We jokingly said we're not sure what's in it, but they did create a group because NEJM has been very singular in not producing any spin-off journals. They had considered it 10 or 15 years ago and declined. I always wonder in retrospect if they think they may have made a mistake by not launching other journals. But baby CERCs keep giving birth to new CERCs. And I don't know what Lancet's future is, but I suspect they're going to debut Lancet Pulmonary or Respiratory in the fall, I believe the plan is. I have a feeling they're not going to stop there. Our new website, people probably know that we're moving from Highwire to Silverchair. We will launch sometime in the next couple months. I think when you come to the website, there'll be some really interesting things. This carousel will turn, it will be graphically enriched. But one of the things that's supposed to be dramatically different, I've seen some key elements of it, is something that someone's going to talk about later, which is the way in which material relates to material. So rather than searching by keywords, which is really tiresome, because if you put a keyword into our current website, you'll get hundreds of articles that are really unrelated. So semantic tagging is the next great leap forward. It's not quite free text search, which I heard about 20 years ago, and people told me it was around the corner, but 20 years later, free text search is yet to be available. But this is a search based on conceptual models rather than by word matching. So it searches on content and matches on content versus keywords, and it hones searches in a way that may be helpful. You know, I think we presume it will be helpful. We will see how helpful it is. And that should have been JAMA. This is Archives. The app, we're a little slow. I love NEJM's app. I love Lancet's app. I love BMJ's app. So ours is coming. Need to understand our audience. We really do need to be an agnostic communicator. People need to model out their journals. The tablet is disruptive.
Surprises lurk everywhere.
Be nimble, be quick,
and embrace technology wisely.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I have a few questions.
Yeah.
So, Hal, thanks ever so much for that really interesting talk. We've got about 15 minutes for questions. So, anybody want to ask Hal a question?
Dr. Fraser, by the way, Central. You made a point that tablets were different from the web. What experiments have been like that?
Where you can carry them.
Yes.
Okay, so I would start with the basic that you're no longer tethered in any way. Secondly, the newer tablets visually are really quite enhanced, and so I think data optimization may work far better with a tablet than it does currently with a regular screen. And then I think the potential for audio and visual, particularly audio, it's just easier with the tablet when you're walking around. I mean, I'm amazed how many people now plug into their tablet, you know, like when I travel and they're listening. So it may be very important as you move to a tablet with a lot of your material to make sure it's audio enhanced. I would also say English is a dominant language for science. It's not the only language in the world, okay? So I traveled to Brazil, a market everyone wants into. Okay, I met with 1,000 leading pediatricians, the academic elite. Only 10% spoke English. So this notion that everyone speaks English in academic medicine around the world, I think, is somewhat inaccurate. I would say when I asked them what is it that they would want from a journal, they were very clear about what they want. They want exactly the way most of our readers look at our journal. They look at the table of contents and they read abstracts. After that, they select probably less than 10% of our content to read. And when I spoke to my Brazilian colleagues, what they said is, can you deliver the electronic table of contents and your abstracts in Portuguese? That's all we want. You don't have to deliver all of your content, but it would make it so much easier if it was in a language that we can read quickly, and then we can move beyond that. And I could have the attitude, well, I really want you to read it in English, okay? Or maybe I could say, maybe they're right, and I need to do a better job about delivering our content in more than English. That will be easier and more transferable in a tablet than, again, if you're tethered to a website. You can certainly do it in a website, but I think people learn on the move or in different rooms. And that's why I think people just need to be so cognizant about how things will play out on the tablet.
Thanks. So finally, what percentage of the content in JAMA is actually solicited or actually created in-house? Is it mostly work that comes from people who are sending work to JAMA, or is it actually work that you actually ask from?
Okay, so the structure of each issue, we have 4 to 5 original research reports. That is always comes from outside the institution.
Okay.
All of our viewpoints, which are 3 in issue, come from outside of the Chicago office.
Okay.
Although of the viewpoints, 2/3 of them are from our cadre of writers.
Okay. Good.
And I think by creating a cadre of writers, you know you're going to get high quality content. I mean, these are the best writers in America. So that's really helpful. Even though we reject some of their papers, they're not very happy. For me personally, it's really hard to say to Bob Brook, I don't like this piece, okay? But on the other hand, there is a check and balances. All of the news is produced in-house.
Okay.
Most of the editorials, all of the editorials are external, but they're internally peer-reviewed. So most of the material is still produced outside.
Okay.
But the question is, how is it peer-reviewed? So the way I would distinguish is all of the original content is externally peer-reviewed. All of the material is peer-reviewed, but much of it is reviewed internally. So viewpoints and editorials are internally peer-reviewed.
Okay. And do you think it's going to go in the direction where more of the work is going to be actually solicited and actually created in-house rather than being actually, you know, that proportion of the actual content is going to increase in time? Or is
it
going to
I think our balance for a weekly, which is very different than a monthly.
Yeah.
So if you look at the structure of monthlies, it is somewhat different than weeklies. And the four weeklies are, it's amazing how identical they are. We're 2/3 value-added material, 1/3 original research.
Okay.
We're very similar to one another. We seem to kind of watch what each other's
so
doing. We may have followed the same pattern. And I think most of it will be pretty similar, where original research will be externally peer-reviewed.
Yes.
The rest will be a mix of internal versus external.
Okay. Okay.
Good. Right, thanks. Very nice talk. Can you just tell us a bit more about your semantic tagging strategy?
No, but he will. So I'd rather stay away from it. They've explained it to me, but I'm like, there's this state in the U.S. called Missouri. You have to show me. They've shown me a little bit. I'm skeptical. I don't defend some of the things we do at JAMA. I want to see how much better it is, okay? I've seen some elements that make me think it's much better, and I do think it's the next great change in the way we search, but I need to have more people do it and tell me.
Okay.
The elements I've seen is that it would take a search of 1,000 titles if you did word search and get that 1,000 down to 50, okay? The real power for us, though, is that we have CME produced in 10 journals. They're not linked in any way. Semantic tagging is going to allow a surgeon to come to our website and find all of the CME on a particular surgical topic. That is enormously powerful for someone, for a journal that wants to do more CME. So you can do that by just word matching, but semantic tagging will enhance the quality of that search, so that it's going to be more limited and more focused on what the terms were.
I suspect that's going to be well covered in the next
episode. Yeah, so I won't say any more.
Paula.
You mentioned that one of the journals has more than 50% of the advertising in digital. What opportunities were given the advertisers to make them switch in terms of location or whatever kind of co-efforts were created?
Little changes. Right now we've tried to mimic the placement in print on the web. I would say I'm not certain that that's been the best policy. So next week I'm actually meeting with our advertising people to go over where placement on the web, where we're comfortable with it and where we're not comfortable with it. We have a locked well, so if you look at JAMA, once you get to a certain part of JAMA, until you get to the end of that part, no ads are allowed. Most journals have avoided any ads next to articles of the same type, okay? But where it's placed on the screen is obviously very different than where it is on the page. I think our policy has been conservative. I think it's the right policy. On the other hand, I think there's someone from the AAP here, the American Academy of Pediatrics. They were on. Is there someone here from the AAP? Anyway, Lewis First for the AAP has experimented with putting more ads in certain places next to HTLM and PDFs than any other journal. He did it for 3 or 4 months as an experiment. They were trying to enhance revenue. I don't know all the details. And I spoke to him and I said, was there any protest? He said, no. People pay no attention to it. They just click on through. Now, that's not very good for advertisers to hear, but on the other hand, I think younger readers pay almost no attention to it. I always use, for me, the bellwether is the New York Times. We don't have $50 million to spend to figure out our web presence. I mean, the estimate is they spend close to $50 million to figure out what they've come up with, which is, now I get locked out of after 20 articles, and then next month I think I get locked out of after 10 articles, unless I spend 99 cents a month, something like that. But just look at where they intrude on when you read. Now, what I really do appreciate in any of the intrusions is that I can turn it off. So the sites that irritate me the most is when there is an intrusion into what I'm reading, but I have to watch the entire 15-second commercial. But we're going to reconsider where we place it. I don't know if the internet advertising has been that successful, but the print advertising in this journal has gone down. So part of it is just that the balance has changed.
But I do think advertisers are learning. If you give them good web statistics, you know, it'll be interesting to see what happens with this usage factor, which I suspect will be as manipulated as the impact factor. But this usage factor is going to be interesting to me. It'll be interesting to see how advertisers use it.
Okay, there was another question. Yes.
James Butcher, Venture Publishing Group. I was very interested by
you. You have a great group, by the way. Your graphics are fantastic.
Thank you very much. I was interested in your talk. You didn't mention open access in any way.
Yeah.
And I would also be interested to hear your thoughts. If, say, the World of Trust, Max Planck, and Howard Hughes launched a new journal called eDeath, a clinical journal, in November, how would that affect what you did as editor-in-chief of JAMA?
Well, are you going to tell all the Howard Hughes investigators that they can only publish in eDeath? I doubt you're going to restrict them. Okay, so to answer the last question first, I think Howard Hughes, Wellcome, and Max Planck are extraordinary places, but I believe they've supported and continue to support transparency and movement of information freely. So I doubt they'll restrict their investigators. So I think eLife will be successful, but I don't think Nature has much to worry about, at least for a few years. Open access. Richard Smith, Fee Godley, I, and others spent hours 15 years ago trying to understand open access. Would it lead to the death of journals? It's been a pretty good decade for journals, okay? I think it's very hard to predict the relationship between open access and so-called hybrid or closed access journals. Much of it in the United States is subject to the legal process about when NIH investigators are subject to ensure that data is made available. As you know, that's been hotly debated. Should it be at the time of publication? Should it be 6 months? Should it be a year? I think what has surprised many of the NIH has been the pushback from NIH-supported investigators, not industry. So my NIH-supported investigators at BU are not very happy about making data available at the time of publication of their initial article. And why? Because they've spent 5 years collecting those data, and they want to spend another 5 years analyzing those data. So I don't know what the right balance is. And only the last point I would make. I think I'm uncertain about open access and its relationship to some of the other journals. I think that the next great quagmire is who's going to hold the data and who will have access to those data. I can tell you, having worked with the NLM, they don't want to be the holder of those data. It's a nightmare. They struggle with the genetic data bank. They don't want the 5,000 RCTs produced to be held by the NLM. And I can tell you as a journal editor, and I know there's many journal publishers here, I don't think they want to hold those data, okay? I love Harvard University. I doubt Harvard wants to hold all of the data for their investigators on the public website. So I think both open access is uncertain to me as to who will hold the data. I think those are the great unknowns for the next decade.
Interesting. Thanks, Howard. I think actually, yeah, it's interesting. I think the editors of Nature, Lancet, JAMA, probably, I think you might have a bigger job on your hand than you might think in terms of mandates over the next few years. I think there's a growing swell at the moment.
Well, when I started this job, I had no white hair, so all the white hair I get, I try to proportion it. This is from struggling around the cover. This is around struggling with the new policy. I think data access may be the next big splotch of white hair.
Were there any other questions that I have? Yes, at the front.
I'm Seema Kang, Lancet. Nice you have white hair.
Yeah.
Your idea of video and disseminating it to the news station, I think that sounds really fascinating. And how, in terms of news stations, how have they been with regards to uptaking your own made video as opposed to them doing something more independent?
I don't know what it's like in the UK. In the US, for news stations, their ability to produce health videos has plummeted from a financial standpoint. So our uptake over the last 3 years has been extraordinary. It's in part because their budgets have become so profoundly limited. Also, they can stream those videos on their website. So for them, it's fabulous. Okay, so you can go to ABC in Chicago and get our JAMA news video. So for us, it's our commitment to move our information, or a limited part of our information, into the public domain. What's really interesting is the discussion, I'm glad it's not audio tape, the discussion we have each week when we nominate which video it should be. Because we know certain types of videos are more attractive to the news media stations and the public, but they may not be the ones that we actually think have more scientific validity. So we have to balance sort of what Jan Inkmeyer, who's wonderful, who would like us, what we know what she would like from us, but sometimes we think a different article has kind of more important medical news. But we know anything with multivitamins, people love. It's just kind of interesting. We know anything about autism, even if it's scientifically incorrect, is important in America. It's just fascinating. And I sometimes laugh. I go, God, if people could only hear these discussions when we try to choose which article.
Okay. So I think, unless there are any more burning questions, we're going to give you a big round of applause and thanks very much, Jim.